Let's get started. Go to, where did we end off? Can you remember? Yeah, chapter 1 verse 10, which says that he's coming in the saints. Not like we understand, like coming on a cloud. He's coming in the saints. So people will see, wait, that's Christ. You know, it'll be made visible. And I want you to understand something, you know, because, look, I'm not trying to take away, you know, remember last night I said that if he has to come physically, I don't understand how the dynamics really are all there, because I believe you'll see him. But you should read 1 John, you know, it's 1 John 3. So we'll see Christ in everyone. But I want you to know and understand as well, before we carry on, this is off the message, that there is a uniqueness to you. You know, so if you go to God, you know, people have got this idea that if you come to God, then you're like this filthy person, and he looks at you, and who's that? You know, full of sin. Just wait, let me get my Jesus glasses on. Which is, you know, we think it's something like that. But there's such a uniqueness to you. So if he looks at me, he sees Bruce. You know, he doesn't eliminate Bruce and see Jesus. He sees Bruce. The uniqueness of who you are. You know, you are his son. You are his daughter. You have to understand. So I was listening to them speak now. It's amazing that how we get to know pastors or people in general. It's like, do you know Joshua, the guy Joshua? Who's Joshua? That pastor, what pastor? That guy who cheated on his wife? Oh, yes, yeah, I know that one. You know, we know people like that. You know, the guy did that. We know them by their, you know, yeah, their deeds. We know them. Yeah, we don't know their names, but we know what they've done. Yeah, so you put the name, the connection. That's why we no longer know any man according to the flesh. We no longer know any man according to the junk and the rubbish. We see Christ, the new species, and who they are. So it's got, Amen. There's no accuser. There's no weapon. Look, there is an accuser. There's just no accuser in heaven. And there's an accuser that you need to get under your feet. Okay? Yeah. So you have to understand, like, if people come to talk to you about the guy that cheated, it's the nature of the accuser. So gossip, this is interesting. I don't know why I'm talking about this, but maybe it's good. Gossip is the opposite spirit of prophecy, just so you know that. Completely opposite. So gossip, and it's the nature of the accuser. And gossip cripples the spirit of prophecy, if you want to think of it like it. Gossip cripples prophecy, it's said like that. So we know each other according to the truth of the word. Amen. So I got no idea how I'm going to do this, because I know what I want to say, but we must just go for it. The word will help us. Go to Luke. Luke chapter 9. Remember, we're speaking about invisibility. Visibility. The Father wants to be made visible. The Son must desire to make the Father visible. The Father desires to make the Son visible. Okay? If you understand that, you understand it. That's the heart of ministry. It's so simple. The Son doesn't desire to make the Son visible. Look at me. No. It's the Son desires to make the Father visible. Hey, my Father loves you. You know, I can only do what I see my Father doing. The works that I do, they are not my own, they are my Father's. Speak not of my own authority, I speak of my Father. Yeah? This is my Son. This is my Son. I have glorified it, I'll glorify again. You know? So the Father will reveal the Son. So now, remember what I said. Yeah, this will be good. Yes, this is the Spirit of God. When Jesus walked earth, no one looked at him and said, "There you are, Son of God." It wasn't obvious because he appeared as a human being. So he appeared and so you must be Son of Mary. You know, and even he himself said, "Son of Man." So he appeared, the Son of Man. But God's heart was to show the world Son of God. Okay? And then you go to Romans chapter 1, verse 4. I explained that he was openly designated the Son of God by the resurrection. So before the cross, remember I told you, Jesus was the only Son. Okay? But it was a mystery. It was like hidden unless people had a revelation. After the cross, the Bible says he's now the firstborn from amongst the dead. The firstborn from amongst many brothers. Okay, so when we become sons of God, doesn't mean we become sons of Mary. Otherwise, we'd have to be born of Mary. So how do we get born? From the tomb. So in Christ, you die and you're born, you know, you're born by the resurrection. Okay, so you're a son of God by the resurrection. You understand what I'm saying? So it's just a thing. That's why you must also understand that it's not necessary for you to physically die, just change. Okay, he took your death, he experienced your death. Okay, so you died the day that Christ was crucified. You died, okay, as good as dead. When you were raised, when Jesus was raised, you were raised. When he was seated, he was seated. You talk about all of that, and then you understand the manifestation of the sons of God. So something must change. Okay, something must be made visible. Because still when people see me, I said it last night, you look like your mom. Wow, you look like your dad. You know, and some of the scary thing is sometimes I do stuff and I'm doing stuff like my old man. It's like, what? Get out of me, you know? But the truth and reality is that you're a son, okay? That's good. Okay, so he was openly designated the Son of God. So go to Luke chapter 9. I hope it's falling because I know I'm emphasizing the same thing the whole time. But like looking to the invisible. All right. Luke chapter 9. Was it here this morning? Yeah, it's here. Luke chapter 9 verse 28. Now about 8 days... after these teachings, Jesus took with him Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And he was, as he was praying, the appearance, okay. What's up, Moses? As he was praying, the appearance, say appearance.
Yes.
Okay. As he was praying, the appearance of his countenance became altered. All right, he changed. He appeared differently. Okay, the Son of Man appeared differently. He changed. Okay, so Paul writes and he says, "We shall not all fall asleep in death, but we shall all be changed." Okay, so his appearance changed. This is so awesome. I'll read it again. As he was praying, the appearance of his countenance became altered. His raiment became dazzling white, flashing with the brilliance of lightning. And behold, two men were conversing with him, Moses and Elijah. Okay. So now what happened when he appeared or when his appearance changed? There were two men talking to him. So two men appeared. All right, this is good. This is very deep, but you'll get it. Okay, then listen to what it says in the King James. It says it, emphasize it. Verse 30, behold, there talked with him two men, which were Moses and Elijah, who appeared. They also appeared. Where did they appear? In glory. Yeah, you see that? So now you have to first understand, where did Jesus go? They went on a mountain. Where's a mountain? Earth. Okay? All right, so where were they? On earth. Now, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 12, I think. Is it 1 Corinthians? No. Yeah, somewhere. It's in the Bible. It is written. It is written. He says, you know, I know a man, how many years ago, who was caught up. Whether in the body, caught up to the third heaven, remember? Whether in the body or out, I don't know. And now, he was speaking about himself on the road to Damascus. If you haven't done the study, it's there. Trust me. We're not going to go there. But it says he was caught up. Yeah? 2 Corinthians 12 verse 2. He was caught up, say caught up, to the third heaven. And he says, whether in the body or out the body, I don't know. All right? So he doesn't know how to explain this thing, what's happening. But the people around him, they heard a voice. Paul on the road to Damascus, you'll find that in Acts chapter 9. Paul hears, Paul sees Jesus. Okay, who are you, Lord? You know, I'm Jesus who you're persecuting. He doesn't understand. And it says, I heard and saw things which were unlawful or something to utter in 2 Corinthians 12. So now you have to understand, where was Paul? On the ground. Everyone standing around him saw Paul on ground. But Paul says, hey, I don't know if I was in the body or out the body. Can't explain it. Okay. Now Jesus takes Peter, James, and John. They go onto a mountain. I don't think Luke says it this way, but Luke skips one of the most important parts. Keep your finger there and go to Mark chapter 9. Luke, it's in Mark and Luke, but keep your finger in Mark and go back to Luke 9. Sorry, guys. This is good. Okay, so let's just read on. Luke chapter 9. All right. So his appearance changed, and behold, two men appeared, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glory. So they appeared in glory. Keep your finger there, go to Colossians chapter 3. Are you on your way? They say Shakabundi. Shando. All right. Verse 4. Colossians 3. Did I say? Colossians 3, verse 4. It says, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him, where? In glory. Oh, my word. So when Christ, who is our life, appears, you will appear with him in glory. So here comes Jesus, the countenance, his appearance changes, and here Moses and Elijah appears with him in glory. Wow. Okay, it's so good. And so when Christ, who is our life, now, Christ is not the center of your life. You must know that. You know, we sing that song. It's a good song to sing. But Christ is not the center of your life. Christ is your life. When Christ, who is our life, appears. So the mystery which was hidden from ages and generations, okay, is now revealed. What is it? Christ in you, Christ in me is our life, the hope of glory. So when this life appears, you'll appear with him in glory. Okay? Just pause and seal and think about it, imagine it, and see it. So it's not necessarily a coming, as in the sense, yeah, he comes and there we go, and there we feast. You know, for 7 years we come back and then. It's just this glory that invades earth, okay? Shouldn't maybe not have said that now, but anyways. Go back to Luke 9. Okay. Oh, this is so awesome. Verse 31, who appeared in splendor and majesty and brightness, and they were speaking of his exit, which he was about to bring to realization at Jerusalem. Now, your finger is still in Mark 9, right? Go to Mark 9. Verse 4, it says, Elijah appeared to them and accompanied by Moses, and they were holding a conversation with Jesus. Peter took up the conversation saying, Master, it is good, let's build tents, you know, whatever. Verse 7, and a cloud threw a shadow upon them, and a voice out of the cloud. Go back to Luke 9. Keep your finger in Mark 9. You can find this in Matthew 17 as well, if you just want to do an in-depth study on the Mount of Transfiguration, what happened there. Okay. Verse 34. But even as he was saying this, a cloud came and began to overshadow them. What came? A cloud. A cloud came and began to overshadow them, and they were seized with alarm and struck with fear. Listen to this. As they entered the cloud. Wow. Wow. So a cloud comes. Yeah, this is great. So they appear. Okay, there's an appearance. There's a change. Elijah appears. They have a talk about his exit, okay? Which was, I would say it is the cross, the resurrection, and the ascension. That's what I would say, okay? And this cloud overshadows them, and they enter the cloud. Not, they enter the cloud, okay? You hear what I'm saying? They enter the cloud. So where are they? They're on the mountain. They see Moses and Elijah. A cloud comes. And they enter the cloud. Okay. So now, you could say that was caught up. Okay. So caught up is not necessarily like the... caught up is like, wow. That's caught up. Wow. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. The lady with the yellow there, do you have a daughter? A daughter? You're saying me. Do you have children? You're not married? Are you married? How long? 4 years. Oh, my word. Because I see like a daughter. No, you know, it's you know, usually when you prophesy a child, it's like most people don't want, okay? But if you want, I just saw it on you, okay? Yeah, saw a daughter. Saw someone like really close. Yeah. Yeah, so. I don't know. Yeah. It's like M or something, I don't know. Something with M, huh? Man, okay, here we go. There we go. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, the Lord knows you. Wow, cool. Bless you. Just be blessed. It's awesome. It's glory. Yeah. All right, so they entered the cloud. Now listen what happened. Verse 35. Sorry, we're going at a slow pace now, but this, I want you to just sink it in. Then there came a voice out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one, my beloved. Listen to and obey him." And when the voice had died, Jesus was found there alone. And they kept still and told no one at that time. It was important for them to tell no one because it was out of time. He was literally openly revealed Son of God right there before time, before the right time. Romans 1 verse 4 says he was openly designated the Son by the resurrection. So right there, these guys had a glimpse of this appearance and a confirmation. This is my son. Come on. Yeah, this is good. So there was this mountain, earth. There was the cloud. There was the voice. There was the revealing. There was the appearing. Okay, you got it. So when Christ, who is our life, appears, okay, not when the church disappears. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will appear with him. Where will you appear? In glory. Now, where the whole earth will what? Be filled with the glory. The whole earth will be filled. Come on, somebody. He said, God said, "As surely as I live, the whole earth will be full of the glory." So when Christ, who is our life, appears, you'll appear with him in glory, / on earth, in glory, on the mountain, in the cloud, in the body, I don't know. How do I explain that? But one thing for sure is you're not disappearing, you're appearing. Okay, you're being made visible for who you really are. You're not going because you can't handle the pressures of life. You're appearing in a victorious and a triumphant manner. Amen? Okay. I thought that was really good. But if you read Mark 9, it just kind of emphasizes it. It says, like if you understand verse 9, it says, as they were coming back down the mountain, he admonished and expressly ordered them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man should rise from the dead. You understand the thing of the time issue. It was out of time, but completely out of the time. And that's why, I mean, I believe in immortality and I believe in this manifestation. I believe there's a time period when it will happen, but I believe we are not limited to time. We're not limited to time. It has to be a by faith. Because when Jesus had a conversation with Martha, he said, "Your brother will rise." Okay? And she answered correctly. She said, "I know he will rise at the last day. Because there's a time." And then he said to her, "Martha, I am the resurrection. I am the life." Come on. Okay, I am is now. I am right now. Now faith. Until now. So there has to be a generation now. So when is the time? Now. Until someone realizes it's
now.
Yeah, come on, someone. All right, so there was a timing for Jesus. And then when he was resurrected, the first thing he says to Mary, he says, "Go tell my brothers." Yay. Just that statement is enough. It was the first time he ever called his disciples brothers. Up until then, it was friends, but now it's brothers. Now it's not only son, now it's sons. So 1 John 3 says, "Beloved, now are we the sons." When?
Now.
Now. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Yeah, it's good. I mean, yeah, this is solid. Okay. There's so much that I can, for those who want to take notes, I'll give you a couple of scriptures and you go read it home, all right? So we're not gonna go into that now, but I'll give you some scriptures. Jesus, where are these scriptures? All right. 1 Timothy 3, verse 16. It explains that he was seen of angels, okay? That was the first appearing. I'm going to mention all the scriptures where Christ appeared, okay? In the first, in the flesh, and then another appearing. 1 John 3, verse 5, you can write down. It's just homework. Go check it out. Oh, we have to read 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10. Yeah, that one is the classic one, but that will be... Can we read that one? 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10. Okay, now remember, we've been emphasizing certain words. So if you want revelation when you read it, emphasize it, okay? All right, 2 Timothy 1, verse 10. It is that purpose and grace which now has made known and is fully disclosed or revealed and made real to us through the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who annulled death, made it of no effect, and brought life and immortality to light. He revealed it. If you can see it, you can have it. He brought it to light through the gospel. All right, let's. That one we saw, Hebrews 9:26 and Hebrews 9:28. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. 1 John 3, verse 2, we read. Am I going too fast? 1 Peter 5, verse 4. 1 Timothy 6, verse 14 to 16. You can read them up. And Philippians 3, verse 20. Okay. That's all good. That's good. Okay, go to John chapter 4. Don't you just love the word? When you hear it, you get an appetite for the word, eh? So it's like in the flesh, the more in natural, if you take food, you eat. The more you eat, the less you want to eat. In the spirit, the more you eat, the more you want. You know, the more you experience, the more you want. So it's like awesome. All right. John chapter 4. This is my favorite scripture. Every now and then I find another favorite, but this is definitely one of them. Okay. It says here, verse 34, let's start there. Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish and completely finish his work." Verse 35. "Do you not say, it is still 4 months until harvest time comes?" Okay, so when you consider the natural, I don't know, I'm not a farmer, so I don't understand that, but there's a time you sow seed and then you wait for the harvest, okay? So Jesus says, you say, it's still 4 months. Okay, I know my brother will rise on the last day. Okay, do you not say it is still 4 months until harvest time? Are they right? Absolutely. Absolutely right. Logical. The logical approach. You're right. There's 4 months until harvest time comes. What does Jesus say? Look. All right? Look. Someone say look. Or see or behold. All right? Look, I tell you, Jesus says, raise your eyes, observe the fields, and see how they are already white for harvesting. When?
Now.
You have to get a supernatural perspective. You cannot, as a church, we cannot go by having a natural perspective. As long as you have a natural outlook, you'll wait and it will happen maybe one day for another generation. 4 months. Still 4 months. On the last day, you'll come. But there must be a generation that raises their eyes, looks away from the natural, looks straight into the invisible. Okay? Gets a supernatural perspective. Oh, Jesus, come on. Come on. All right, verse 37. For in the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap a crop for which you have not toiled. Other men have labored and you have stepped in to reap the results of their work. That is some of my most favorite scriptures. Thank you, Jesus. All right, so now go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I should have read it earlier. 1 Thessalonians 4. It says in verse 17, then we who are alive and remain on earth shall be caught up. Oh, are we going to be caught up? Paul was caught up while he was lying there next to his horse. He was caught up. The people around him saw. He was caught up. Okay? Some of you guys like looking at me like, hey. He was caught up. We who are alive and remain shall be caught up along with the resurrected dead in the clouds. Okay? So let me ask you, what happened? When Jesus and the disciples were on the mountain, and right through scripture, Moses, wherever it was, wherever the cloud was, there was like God. Okay? Where was the cloud? On the mountain. Around him. Hey, I don't know how to explain that. Okay? Be caught up along with the dead in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. Where? In glory. Okay? Where's the cloud around us? What came from the cloud? A voice. Do you think this cloud was like a fluffy cloud that came? No. No, there's a little cloud. I've been in clouds. You know, it explains like this fear that they experience is natural. I've lost my thought. Jesus, come back. So the Bible says in Hebrews 12, we are surrounded by this cloud of witnesses. Where are they? There, somewhere there, watching there. No, they're all around. So heaven is around you, okay? Not in altitude, in attitude. It's a higher attitude. It's higher in attitude, not higher in altitude. So all around you is heaven, all right? We explained it last time, but he says, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. So wherever earth is, that's the footstool. Wherever earth stops, that's the throne. What is the throne? Heaven. Heaven is all around you. Okay? You happen to be, I'd say, the release, the gate, or whatever you want to call it, for now. It is falling. Thank you, Jesus. It changes everything. It changes your outlook. You know, when you realize that you are Christ, you know, it can show you are Christ. You are Christ. You have a new nature. You know, God is your Father. If God is your Father, you're a God. He's not ashamed to call you brothers. Hey, do you know who you are? I don't know if you really get it completely, but if you start to look into the Word and you see the glory of the Lord, you're being changed. Your appearance is changing. Before you know it, you walk in here and everything is different. And you're like, where's the wicked? They're gone. There's nothing here. You know? Where's wickedness gone? It's just glory. It's just glory. It's just glory. Okay. Just so you know as well, it's just you should try and go on YouTube. There's two sermons that I preached that spurred to it. I must try and upload a bit more teachings that I have that I did there. But there's one that kind of explains why the apostles had to die. You know, it was important for the apostles to die. And then there was also, that's why there was a big debate on John. You know, why is this one, is he not going to die? But Paul explains, he says, my life must be poured out like lifeblood, a lifeblood. Okay, but I'm not going to get technical about that now. So, could we go 1 John, oh my goodness, 2 Timothy, chapter 4. Paul writes here, for I'm ready, I'm already about to be sacrificed. The time of my spirit's release from the body is at hand, and I will soon go free. Verse 7 now. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Verse 8, Paul writes here, as to what remains henceforth, there is laid up for me the victor's crown of righteousness. You must try and watch. I put a message up on Jesus Emphasized. Yeah, Jesus Emphasized. You must watch that one. A crown of righteousness for being right with God. Okay, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me and recompense on that day. Now listen to you. And not to me only, but also to all those who have loved and yearned for and welcomed his appearing. Amen. You say it's still 4 months. You read that, you want to postpone it. Jesus said, raise your eyes, look, love is appearing. Love is appearing. 1 John 3. And we summarize everything through you. It's, who will declare his generation? Yeah, we will declare his generation. And we believe it. What a time for an announcement. You know, I remember, I want to tell the story because if you know me, a lot of the fruit that I walk in is like inherited, like the way I preach. I know I spent years with Prophet Corbus, years with him, you know, and I just watched him. And he brought this message, you know. A lot has opened up to me since he's passed, because I just said, I'm going to preach this. And I remember standing at the funeral. The casket was standing here. And everyone was like taking the mic and saying, oh, we're going to miss you. And it was like sad because we were grieving. And I remember just standing there and I said, I will preach this message relentlessly. And I will not stop. You know, and I stood there and it was like something just stirred in the inside of me. And this stuff really started to open up to me, you know. I had so much dreams and encounters with God, and even a prophet would appear to me, and had so much dreams about this. But anyways, I stood there and Psalm 102 started running through my head. And remember, we quoted it. It says, let this be recorded for a generation not yet born. Okay? The people will praise the Lord. Okay? It says, tell them. And when I saw tell them, I was freaked out because there was a messenger that told me. What? I said, there's a messenger that told me. It is a recording, and then there's a messenger, and there's the generation. And God always sends a voice. Always a voice before the time. There's always, throughout the scriptures, there's always a voice before the time. And their voice, the announcements, and then it comes into manifestation. This is, tell them that the Lord looked down from his heavenly sanctuary, okay, to hear the sighings and the groanings of the prisoner, to loose them who were appointed to death. I said, yes, Lord, I've heard. Now I'll run with it. Yeah? And I'll believe it. We're believers. We're not reasoners. Okay? We don't consider what our bodies look like. We don't consider what the news is telling us. New Antichrist. We don't consider that. We look to Jesus. We look for the appearing. We look to the glory. Come on, someone. Will you get a new perspective? Will you get a supernatural perspective? As long as you consider what's visible, you'll be caught up in a temporal, decaying thing. But we don't see things like that. We don't. We look away, and we raise our eyes. Amen? Yeah, and I just stood there. I said, I'll preach this relentlessly. Tell them. Tell them. Who will declare his generation? Yeah, it's time. The Christ generation. Okay. The earth remains forever. The Christ remains forever. Now these three things remain. Faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. God is love. No man at any time has ever seen God. But if we love one another, okay, God's love is made perfect in us, and etc. So, love brings manifestation. Okay? The love of God makes God visible. When you make God visible, he makes you visible. Glory. If you don't know what glory is glory is everything God is and everything God has. That's glory. You look into the Word to see the glory of the Lord. Those who do that are changing from one degree of glory to another. Not glory to glory to glory to glory to glory to glory. No, from a fading glory to a remaining glory. Okay? From one that fades to one that remains. Glory. It's so good. I'm telling you, if you understand this, miracles, signs, and wonders is easy. It's just easy. Revelation. All right, so let's finish the conference with this scripture, and then we'll do the offering and maybe some impartation, and then some prayers, and then selfies. What? Prophecies. All right. Everyone wants prophecy. Yeah, everyone wants a prophecy. I've just prophesied for an hour and a half. This is prophecy. Did you know that this is prophecy in its finest form? This is prophecy. You desire a word of knowledge. This is prophecy. Okay. I'm going to just say it again. Santosh, I really believe that this conference is, there's something special happening in you, man. Really, really believe it. Really believe it. Really, really believe it. Is there somebody with purple socks on? Purple socks. A man. You got like a purple, pinkish kind of sock. You know that real men wear pink. Come on. Don't be ashamed. Like a purple kind of sock. Okay, well. Is it you? Let me see. This is faith, eh? Let me see. Show me. Wow, yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. You've made my day. There'll be a special, special prophecy for them. Well, I'll minister to them. I promise you. Oh, well. Because that's what I saw. Yeah, pink socks. All right, let's just read. 1 John 3 verse 1. See what an incredible quality of love the Father has given, that we should be named and called and counted the children of God. And so we are. The reason that the world does not know us is that it does not know Him. So the Son's responsibility is to make Him known, is to reveal the Father to the world. The Father loves the world. You know, he loves the world. And so they reject you because they don't know the Father. But he will reveal you, you know. It's amazing how it works. I love that. Verse 2, beloved, we are even here and now God's children. King James says it better. Now are we the sons of God. Okay, then it says, it is not yet disclosed what we shall be, but we know that when He comes and is manifested, okay, so we know when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then you shall appear with Him. All creation is waiting for the manifestation. Yeah, the manifestation or the revealing. They can't see you if you disappeared. You have to understand that. You have to compare Scripture with Scripture. Yeah. But they'll see you appearing. When He comes and is manifested, whew, whew, guys, this is awesome. You know, the Scripture says, when the perfect comes. Love, speaking about love. God is love. Jesus. When He comes and is manifested, we shall resemble and be like Him, for we shall see Him just as He really is. No man at any time has seen God. We shall see Him as He really is. So we have to start looking. Looking into the glory. When you come here and you worship, worship. You know, go for it. Go for it. Just worship. Expect miracles and signs and wonders to happen in your life like no other. Like no other. My goodness, I want to tell you, my desire is to give everyone a prophecy. But I have to look at myself in the mirror every day and prophesy. Hey, you are this, you are that, you are this, you are that. Prophesy over yourself, brothers. Okay? Prophesy. Prophesy. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Okay? You are more than what you think you are. You are far more greater than what you think you are. Your nature is of Christ. Your father is not a prophet. Please, can I tell you that? That sometimes we've been calling prophets father, papa. It's not. I can tell you, God is your father. Run to him and say, my father. Get your identity there. I'm son of no prophet. No prophet is my father. I understand spiritual father as in fathering someone. But I have one father. One father. God is my father. And Jesus is not ashamed to call me brother. And neither should the prophet be ashamed to call you brother. If he can't call you brother, I'm just saying. I'm touching something, eh? When you run to Jesus, you say, Jesus! Not Prophet Jesus. Prophet Jesus! Why is it? Jesus. I laughed. Where was I? Someone said, what shall I call you? Are you a pastor, prophet? No, brother. Just call me brother. Do you know what you're acknowledging when we do that to one another? My brother, my brother, my brother. When we begin to acknowledge that everyone is Christ. Christ, my brother, beloved in the Lord. So when I see a man of God prophesy, I'm like, I want that. Yes. Yes, I can do that. I want that. I want that. But my identity is in my father. My father. If I can see him do it, I can do it. All right? So you heard a lot. So be careful if you get raptured. I'm just, just, it's not a good thing. But caught up is a good thing. There is more scripture. The Bible emphasizes resurrection right throughout scriptures, while the church is emphasizing rapture, which doesn't appear in the Bible. The Bible emphasizes resurrection, while most of the church is emphasizing. The Bible is emphasizing a earth, while the church is emphasizing heaven. We've switched it around. There is more emphasis placed on earth than there is emphasis on a life in heaven. There is emphasis placed here on earth. It's placed here. Yes, something has to change. Yes, new heaven and new earth. But you know that you're already new. Bible says all things have become new. It just means maybe we're not seeing it, but it must come into manifestation. It's been done. But we're going to see it. That's the thing. Amen. So manifest it. All right. So put your hand on your stomach. Just put it there. John 7 verse 37. He said, on the last and final day of the feast, Jesus stood up and shouted in a loud voice, if any man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And I will cause from his innermost being rivers. Rivers of living water. It goes on to say that he was speaking of the Spirit. So you have the Spirit of God in you. Just right now, just begin to pray in the Spirit. Right now. Shahandra Gurama. Sendra Masubradeshi Alamat. Oh la makrebe shebrandu sata. Jimbra masuregeshi brandeshi kahandra. Elbrahand, come on. Pray with a supernatural perspective. Pray and see the glory. Come on. Lambrumotuse. Shahandrugese. Come on. In a different realm. Bradasum Rageshe. Shimra. Forget about this afternoon's biryani. Forget about whatever has to happen. See Jesus. See the glory. Jahandrugosa.